You're listening to TV Ate My Dinner. This is episode 10. My name is Sean, and I'm sitting here with Brooks.
Hey, how's it going? I'm feeling pumped. I gotta tell you.
I feel good. I feel a little backbeat going on. I feel something coming. A strange undercurrent of anthematic power building.
I feel like I'm ready to start doing some pull-ups in an abandoned barn.
I feel like I'm prepared to do one single pull-up and then be prepared to fight Dolph Lundgren.
Maybe do a couple laps around the lake.
Maybe bench press an entire tree.
Do some kind of karate move on a log and on a beach. Abandoned beach.
Yeah, that's the way it really plays out.
And then take on a biker gang. Clean up a town.
And take the head tough's girlfriend.
And I'm ready for this because I've been listening to some really rockin' tunes. And I strongly encourage any of you out there in internet land, if you're gonna take on an enemy gang of some kind or some kind of big boss character, you really ought to download some of the songs we're gonna talk about tonight, or buy the CDs or however you choose to get your music, and put together a little mix and listen to that while you're pumping your weights, because it's gonna help. It's going to help.
That's what I think. Because all the bad guys, if you notice, listen to crappy techno.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that's why they're ill-prepared for those of us who are ready for 80s power chords and electric guitar. They don't have what it takes. They don't have the chops for this. The karate chops, as it were.
So what we're going to do tonight is our big main subject is we're just going to go over some fun action movie anthems. That are really pumped up and inspirational and you know, cheesy. I mean, because there's a lot of good songs that come from action movies, and I'm going to stay away from those. I'm going to go with the ones that are kind of fun, just borderline ridiculous.
We're gonna try to avoid all good things on this show so far.
Yeah. Well, I mean, people already know about the good things. What fun is talking about the great songs?
Yeah, really. You know what's cool? Star Wars. Yeah. Like, okay, thanks for blowing the lid off of that one for us. That's not us, man. We're here to let you know the things you may have missed, or to remind you of those things you may have forgotten.
Star Wars will never be one of our movies from the vault. You want to kick it off with a movie from the vault? Thomas does.
Hang on. Thomas is... Hey, Thomas. How about you shut the fuck up?
He's pumped.
He's been watching Rocky movies all day.
Now he's ready to go.
Excitable.
Bring it on!
Yeah. And he's not even a boxer. Yeah, I think I've got a movie that will suit our needs.
All right.
Movies from the vault.
And this isn't an 80s anthem movie, but this is an 80s movie. And I guess they probably couldn't afford an anthem is the only reason they didn't have one. But I'm talking about Megaforce. Now, for those of you G.I. Joe fans out there, you may or may not remember this, because this was probably like 82. But this was Barry Bostwick starred, and it was a G.I. Joe style strike force on a fairly incomprehensible mission to jump dirt bikes, parachute out of helicopters, and crack wise. Good, clean, all-American fun.
Mm-hmm.
And this movie literally, like, I don't even know that there was a story. I know they went out into the desert to fight this guy. And then the next thing you know, they're all, like, just riding dirt bikes all over the place, and his flies. It's awesome. And the guy who hires him is the Devon from Knight Rider. I remember that.
Oh, well, that's nice. Does the guy out in the desert, the bad guy, does he have his own little army?
Yes, he's sort of like a Castro-looking dude who used to be friends with Barry Bostwick before he left the Megaforce.
Ooh, twisted. Yeah. That's some
it's
conflict.
Good. It is good old-fashioned. It just cheesy fun. And it co-stars Michael Beck, who's in Xanadu.
Do they all get to wear, like, really cool uniforms like G.I. Joe do?
They do wear jumpsuits, these tan sort of jumpsuits with some kind of, like, Darth Vader sort of chest console thing that doesn't
really
seem to do anything.
Wow.
It's awesome. Barry Bostwick's character is Ace Hunter.
That sounds like a video game from the 80s character.
It's the greatest.
Ace Hunter.
If you ever, I don't even know if it's on DVD. I don't know how you would procure a copy of Megaforce, but if you can, man, I think it's well worth it.
Man, I want to see it now. You got me. I've not seen this.
I know that my copy is one of the big box VHS videos of it, so I don't know. I don't have it on DVD. I don't know if you can get it on DVD.
And kids today who don't remember VHS at all probably certainly won't remember big box, which just means that for some weird unknown reason, the VHS tapes that you probably remember coming in little sleeves that are VHS size at some point in the early days used to come in these huge boxes.
For no reason. And the best movies ever you could. I remember, it must have been about 12 years ago, the local video store put a ton of these on sale. And we got just a treasure trove of these big box, mostly horror movies. And they were all terrible.
Yeah.
But they were all the awesome kind of terrible. I remember we got the ghastly ones. There was some movie called The Scavengers about like just ex-Confederate soldiers who were cutting a swath of rape and pillaging across the countryside.
Didn't you get that Alice Cooper one too? What's it, Monster Dog?
Oh, Monster Dog.
That's a movie from the vault that we're going to have to do one day.
Monster Dog. That is an anthem, too, because it's not an 80s anthem because no one's heard of the movie or the song, but he plays a rock star in the movie, and he sings this song, this identity crisis song.
I've got image out of control.
There you go. Identity crisis.
Oh, that's one for the really big Alice Cooper fan out there. That's an obscure one.
You just busted out a secondary movie from the vault. That's what that is. What's funny about that is that wasn't even the movie I was attempting to buy. I bought the box it came in was for a movie called Mongrel.
Yeah, which also sounds cool. But
yeah, which would have been cool. But then it turned out to be Monster Dog with Alice Cooper. So I think we still got our money's worth. We still got our $3 worth.
Oh, no doubt. So that's almost, I guess, a dual movie from the vault. That's never happened before.
Yeah, so there you go, guys. There's a lot of good stuff we just gave you. We gave you one for free out of that.
It's a double feature.
Oh, man, and what an awesome night that would be. Get yourself Megaforce and Monster Dog. Tell your friends.
Yeah, they may not be your friends in the morning, but...
Well, if they're not into that kind of stuff, they're not the kind of friends you need, all right?
Yeah, that's how you'll know the good ones from the bad ones.
If they don't like the good, cheesy movies... I don't know what to tell you.
You know what's funny about we keep saying the 80s anthems, and you know it's funny because we weren't setting out to make another 80s episode here or talk about 80s movies. It just so happens that all the good anthems come from 80s movies.
It was just the trend.
I don't know why it is. Is in the 90s they said, ooh, we're not going to do that anymore.
Just because of grunge, I think there was more money going into movies by then. That I think the 80s was all about. They made these cheesy movies and they were kind of small. Even the big blockbusters at the time were kind of small. And they would get a soundtrack that was all relatively unknown songs, like songs created just for that soundtrack. And it would always be specifically motivated to, if not the theme of the movie, then a particular scene where they were working out for no reason. And that led to their victory. So I don't think, you know, I think that was a formula that they did at first because it was kind of cheap and easy to do as a formula, but it became something more to us. Like, I miss it.
I think it's a shame that we've lost this genre of music, the anthemic workout rock song from an action movie, because not like that anyone would actually drive around in their, you know, in their convertible Mustang listening to this on their cassette nowadays, but it is fun. It's fun. Like, me and my friends... We play Halo, and, you know, Halo 3 just came out, big to-do. And next Saturday, we're all getting together for this huge party where everyone's going to play Halo and whatever. But what we do is we make what we call a Halo mix, which is just this massive mix of songs that we have on the laptop that we play because, you know, so we don't have to listen to the TV music, the actual, you know, it's just rock songs and techno and stuff. Most of it's stuff like Prodigy and stuff that isn't that good on its own, but it works really well with that kind of setup for some reason. It sounds good when you're stalking somebody on a video game. But we like to mix in stuff like these kind of songs, because they really do get you pumped up. You listen to it by yourself and you look kind of like a weirdo. Mm-hmm. But when you pop it in that kind of party, and it becomes fun. So it's a shame that kind of genre
they get
is
you going,
passed
man.
Away. Maybe it's coming back. I've got an example here of a song that I think might just be bringing it back or attempting to. I don't know how successfully. Live to win, till you die, till the light that's in your eyes. It's called Live to Win. It's by Paul Stanley from Kiss. You might remember him. He had a solo CD.
This is a new song?
Yes, it's a solo CD. It came out in 2006.
Is this on a movie?
It was on the South Park episode called Make Love, Not Warcraft, the one where they all play World of Warcraft and they keep getting killed by this super nerd guy who has a character that's really, really powerful. So they all decide to, all the kids take their characters out into the woods and just start killing sheep to get experience points so they get more powerful, and they do it for like 3 months. And this is the, it's a montage, and this is the song they play on that. And it sounded, when I first heard it, I thought it was something they had made up, because it sounded just like something that Trey Parker and those kids would do, because it's such an completely awesome sounding 80s kind of thing. And I looked it up, and it turns out it's Paul Stanley from Kiss. It's a real song.
It comes off a real album, which is even kind of sadder that the only way it finds purchase is to be in a parody.
I think that it won an Emmy. I can look this up, but I read somewhere that it was at least nominated for an Emmy for that, so that's pretty cool.
It sounds pretty awesome.
Maybe he's bringing it back, or he's trying to.
Well, I'd be cool. I would like to see someone who wasn't around in the 80s try to bring it back, because it's like all the 80s guys are trying to bring it back, because that's where they were awesome.
That's the problem. Whenever you get the younger kids doing this stuff, and they do it sometimes, but they're always making fun of it. And it's not funny when you're trying to be funny, unless you're Trey Parker. In which
no,
case it is.
It's funny when they're like Ronnie James Dio or somebody doing a song, and that's pretty awesome. We're the last in line. See how we shine.
Oh, man. Awesome. Like,
that's awesome.
I feel like lifting weights right now.
You can't top. Oh, my. What's awesome is all of those songs were made by tiny little men who worked out all the time.
Yeah. Or not.
So take a lesson. Those guys played D&D and they got picked on and they pumped up and got big.
And they started belting out anthems, wailing. So that
yeah,
you can get inspired.
Don't act like Glenn Danzig didn't play D&D and read comics.
They're doing it for us. They're trying to inspire us.
The man was 3.5 feet tall, but still, you know, had all heart. They're like the little Rudy's of the world. Just, you're all heart. I wish he had half a Rudy's heart, even though he can't play football worth a damn, even though he's been practicing for 8 years.
Another track that I found, I'd actually talked about this before, so I was happy to be able to find it. It's that song from Bloodsport, the one I talked about in an earlier episode. I guess it was the 80s episode. It's called Fight to Survive. It's by Stan Bush, who, incidentally, and you'll enjoy this, also penned a couple of the songs for the Transformers movie. Not the new one.
Oh, awesome. He did for the animated movie.
Yeah. And he
had a contract with Filmation for a while. Who did that? It wasn't Filmation. Who did that movie?
I don't know. If I knew, that would definitely be a nerd alert.
Cartoons or something.
But let's check these lyrics out. My body's ready. My heart's on fire. I'm going to push it over the wire. These are the kind of things that they always say. These are almost like cliches that make their way into these songs. Perfect timing, tight as a drum. The final battle's already won. And then the coolest part is in the background, these guys, because it's from Bloodsport. They're going, Kumite, Kumite, Kumite,
that's
Kumite.
Awesome. That's right up there with the Iron Eagle theme song. We were talking about that.
I mean, tell me this isn't Trey Parker. The next verse, I've worked hard every night and day, so I'm prepared to make my way. Mind and body are the perfect team. Now's my chance to live my dream.
No, like, you're
really,
a man.
Man?
Wow. A man.
Yeah. Oh, that's on my list, too, of course.
But see, that's a parody, but it is an awesome parody.
Well, it's like the perfect incarnation of this idea. I'll go ahead and say that next. DVDA, which is the band that Trey Parker, that's whenever they record stuff, they call themselves that. I'm not going to get into what it means, but it's kind of gross.
Trey Parker's band.
But
it's from their second movie, Orgasmo.
Orgasmo.
So that'll give you something right there.
And so is this song. I guess it's called Now You're a Man. I don't think it's released in any official capacity that I know, but you can find it online. It's
the main theme song from Orgasmo.
Yeah, it's the song that they play during the end credits, and ooh, is it awesome.
What makes a man? Is it the power in his hands? Is it his quest for glory? Give it all you got to fight to the top, so we can know your story. Now you're a man, a man, man, man. Now you're a man, a man, 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 a man, man, man. You are now a man, you're a man. Now you're a man.
What's best is before the second lyrics is where he's just going, live it, live it.
Yeah.
Because that's totally 80s. Live it.
Oh, man. That.
No, that guy knows exactly how the 80s work.
No doubt.
Knows what
it's
about.
He is a true student of the art of the 80s action movie. He really does live it.
Yeah, he does live it. What is that? We were just talking about the Iron Eagle song, because it's the same thing. And if I'm not wrong, this song is done by King Cobra, is the name
yep,
of the band.
That's correct.
Do you know why I know that? Because I actually used to have this soundtrack on vinyl, and I used to play it on my show on the radio. This Iron Eagle. That never say die, Iron Eagle. That's the best. It's a great song.
The lyrics, I've got that one here too, man. The lyrics are whoa. I like this verse here. This is like the second or third verse. Don't try and bring my soul to the ground. My spirit remembers old mountain magic sounds. Against all odds, I'll come out on top, because I never learned the meaning of what meant stop.
What meant stop? Man.
Like, what? You never learned a lot of things.
I barely even listened to those words. I never meant the meaning of the word stop. Wait, what?
The meaning of what meant stop. That's good stuff. Never say die, Iron Eagle.
That's the good part right there. Because really, you don't remember the words to 80s songs nearly as much as you remember those awesome choruses they would just break into.
Oh, well.
They're all about, gonna climb the mountain and stop the bad guy, yeah.
That's exactly.
Nothing's gonna hold me down. I'll work out and do push-ups till I beat up the jocks.
I'm gonna achieve my dreams.
Achieve my dreams. That's exactly what it's coming from right there. That's Karate Kid right there. We were talking about the Karate Kid theme song too.
Yeah,
because that's
yep.
All. You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep you down.
That's Joe Esposito.
Joe Esposito, nice.
Try to be the best, cause you're only a man, and a man's gotta learn to take it. Try to believe, though the going gets rough, that you gotta hang tough to make it. It's
like, oh, wow. It starts to sound like a Charlie Daniels song when you say it that way. You know, now that I think about it, isn't there another big song from The Karate Kid?
There's that Glory of Love, isn't it, from the Karate Kid?
No, I was going to say that's Karate Kid 2, but I could think there's another, there's another 80s anthem kind of song from, maybe from the end credits of Karate Kid.
I don't know, man. You got me. I mean, I don't doubt it. I'm not a big, big Karate Kid buff.
Oh, I won't rest till we know.
Well, look it up.
I'm on it.
The internet is at your fingertips.
Karate Kid soundtrack. Google Go?
While he's looking that up, I'll bring another one in, because we mentioned Never Say Die, which is the name of that song. That's also, coincidentally, a lyric in the next song I was going to mention. Big surprise. I mean, yeah, such a rare concept, like Never Say Die. This is another Stan Bush song. He's the guy that did that one earlier that I love, the Kumite, Kumite. This song is called Never Surrender, and it's from Kickboxer, another Van Damme movie. So if you guys are ever out looking to do some van damage,
yeah,
that's what I like to call it when you do a roundhouse kick to somebody.
You noodle kick someone in the face.
Yeah, check these out. The lyrics on the first verse. You were born a fighter, and the blood a mighty warrior. Driven by desire, glory calls, it's waiting for you. Like, that doesn't even rhyme.
Sounds awesome.
There's a burning passion deep inside, a silent power with a quick reaction. Lightning strikes, your fight for honor. Oh, all this stuff. Yeah. Good, good.
It's starting to sound like something else is going on here.
there's that undercurrent in a lot of these songs.
Are we about to fight or make out? Hold
on a second.
Is this
a rear naked choke situation?
Yeah, really. Because I got to say, back in the days of the 80s, another constant besides the anthematic power ballad was like, two guys fighting with no shirts on.
Yeah, well,
that happened a lot,
man.
Where people were like, that's fine. You and me about to get butt naked and wrestle.
Well, that's because all these actors are like, I've been working out for 8 months. I want to show off my pics.
I listened to the soundtrack to this song and I did 4 pull-ups. I want people to see my killer abs.
I wish that I could have found some of the stuff from the Roadhouse movie. Do you know that Patrick Swayze did 2 of the songs on that soundtrack?
Patrick Swayze, I love, because you never realize it. He did one of the songs off Dirty Dancing.
Well, that's actually a good song, relatively speaking.
Is that Hungry Eyes?
No, that's Eric Carmen. He did the...
Which one did he do?
The She's Like the Wind, which is a good song. I mean, you know, it's not bad.
No,
I can listen to it.
I love the Dirty Dancing soundtrack, but it's just funny when you think about
now,
that.
Now, the 2 tracks he did on Roadhouse are not as good. Not so much, but they're fun. They're fun. Well, you know, Roadhouse isn't that kind of movie. It's not a She's Like the Wind kind of scene. You know what I mean?
Oh, that's what it is. It's the moment of truth. You're giving it all. Standing in line, ready to fall. That's the other song off Karate
Kid. I don't know if
Kid.
I know that one. Who does it?
If you can do it, get up and prove it. Get up and show them who you are. It says here, Survivor. That can't be true.
It's possible.
I think I'd remember if Survivor did a song off the Karate Kid.
Well, Survivor apparently did like 400 different songs on Rocky. I didn't remember that.
Where would the 80s be without Survivor, even outside of their soundtracks?
Oh, I know. Survivor, I actually do like a lot of their songs. The action anthems, not as much as some of the others. That's the cheesy side of Survivor, no doubt. But
what is that song that The Search Is Over, man?
Oh, yeah.
I still love that song.
Living for a dream. That's like the kind of song that it's a love song, you know? But when girls hear it, they're like, okay.
Whatever.
Where's Wonderful Tonight? Where's something like that? But guys, when guys hear that Search Is Over song, for some reason,
cry.
They get all teary-eyed.
Yeah, man. Well, that's what I'm talking about.
When I touch your hand,
that's how I feel.
I can see forever. It's a guy's love song. You know, like the kind of appeals to the tough
because
dudes.
It is, because the whole song is about how, you know, I've ignored you almost the entire time I've known you, but now that I've tried every other girl, I realize you're not that bad. The girls, surprisingly, don't really cotton to that song as much as the guys. You were with me all the while. It's let's see. It says it's Survivor. Let's see. It's the moment of truth. It's all on the line. This is the place. This is the time. Waited forever. It's now or it's never. Nothing can stop you now.
Well, all right. Awesome.
Yeah, that's... I knew there was another awesome Karate Kid song.
Man,
there.
I've got some other Survivor songs on my list, too. How funny.
Well, man, they've got two songs I can think of off of two separate Rocky movies that were major power ballad anthems.
That's probably the two that I'm thinking about.
Well, you got... everyone knows Eye of the Tiger from Rocky III.
Of course.
But not as many people remember Burning Heart from Rocky IV.
Yep. That's the other one I've got.
And that's the other one. It's like... I can't remember. As I go, it's a burning heart. It's just about true.
To burst.
Yeah. You...
In the warrior's code, there's no surrender. Though his body says stop, his spirit cries. Never deep in our soul, a quiet ember. Knows it's you against you. It's the paradox that drives us all.
There's a quest for answers, an unquenchable thirst. And the darkest night rising like a spire, and the burning heart, the unmistakable fire.
That's where he takes his motorcycle helmet off and he throws it at the big bronze statue of himself because his life sucks so bad.
Yeah.
Screw you, Rocky.
Man.
I can't even afford a motorcycle helmet.
All right.
I love it, man.
I prefer
you gotta love Survivor.
I was living for a dream. I prefer that.
Yeah, exactly. That's, I can hear you whisper.
Are you coming on to me?
The search is over.
Is that what this is about?
You were with me all the while, Brooks. That's all I'm gonna say.
I've noticed a couple of overtures here.
Well, you've been doing poetry slams of Sweaty Man Rock.
Yeah, that's true.
And I gotta say, it's starting to affect me.
There's another song in Rocky IV I was going to mention. I believe the band is called Touch. I don't want to get into that, knowing the kind of mood that you're in, hearing all these erotic lyrics. The Sweetest Victory is the name of this one. Sweetest victory, I love you more than life itself. Sweetest victory, you give me strength to know myself. Oh, sweet victory, my soul is yours and the glory is mine. Glory is a word that you see a lot in these songs. It's all about strength, glory.
It's a returning theme. That's another thing that I kind of like about the optimism of 80s movies is like they're all about not just winning, but battling to win.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it wasn't matter. And that's what the age was about. It's like, okay, we've all been in this situation for about 2 seconds before the story deviates from our lives. You're the new kid. You just moved to a place. You know, you're having trouble at school, and you maybe have a run-in with the local bullies or whatever. Okay, we all get that. But then at some point you meet like some kind of mystic Okinawan karate master who teaches you in 6 weeks how to win like a karate tournament. That's where it stops being real.
You don't think karate?
That's the 80s. The 80s isn't about like you're not
gonna... work as janitors in hotels or wherever the hell that kid lived.
Yeah, exactly. And then he lives in like a magical palace when he goes back to his house.
Yeah.
He lives in the botanical gardens. All on his janitor's pay, his superintendent at the motel.
You know how expensive those little trees are? What do they call those things?
I know. These little bonsais.
Those things
are
expensive.
Especially real ones. And then, but of course, he climbed down and he planted one behind a waterfall one time just to know that it would be safe.
I wonder if the new Rocky movie had any of these kind of songs in it. I haven't seen the new Rocky movie, the recent one.
Yeah, I know, and I feel bad because everyone did say it was really good.
Well, I'm not a big Rocky fan anyway. I like the first one all right, but, you know, I can take it or leave it, so I don't feel that bad about it. But I'm curious if he brought this along or if it's a more modern kind of movie and with all the modern sensibilities. Because, man, the first Rocky had even that, the theme from the first Rocky has that awesome part where the weird choral part where they're like, getting strong now. You know what I'm talking about?
What I like about that too is that this happened a lot more in the 80s and doesn't happen as much now, where you'd have like the composer would write the actual score. Like I think it's Bill Conti writes the score to Rocky. And then they'd get guys to come in and write lyrics. And that's the way that happened too. You know, it's either Bill Conti score and then you just have these people singing that song. And they did that in First Blood too. Like they took the musical theme and make a little song in it at the end. That's very cool. What's the first one where it goes? The road is long.
Oh yeah.
When you're on your own, and it hurts when they tear your dreams apart. It's almost like they just take the score and they play it for a guy, and he sort of does like Jack Black and makes up lyrics while he's listening. And it sucks because they chased you through the woods.
Yeah. They didn't understand your veteran pain.
You guys just completely phone it in. Got a big knife, and I'll take your life.
Man, I think you missed your calling. Too bad you were born too late.
I know. I should have grown up. I should have come up in the 80s writing theme songs.
You could have, like, because there were so many, like, horrible action B movies that came out, these wannabe Van Damme kind of movies. You could have scored all those things. No sweat. Do it in real time. Great. Like, as you're watching the movie, you just hold a microphone up and you sing the whole score right there.
An hour and a half. And I'll kick your face.
And this part's kind of boring.
Let's get back
to the fighting. Yeah.
Got tired and went to rest, but they didn't turn the cameras off.
I need to go to the bathroom. Here comes a love scene. Looks like a good time.
Awesome. Unnecessary boobs.
You got any other inspirational songs? I got tons.
Here's one that you haven't mentioned is Footloose.
Hmm.
Now, Footloose not only has a whole soundtrack full of awesome 80s anthem songs, but it has Holding Out for a Hero with Bonnie Tyler, which is the epitome. It's what people think of.
I guess so. You see, I'm actually...
You know how many movies have used that song since that movie, even though it was already a soundtrack movie to start with?
I know Short Circuit did, or one of
them. Short Circuit 2. Yeah, exactly. And Shrek 2 used it.
I'm actually a big fan of Jim Steinman, the guy that wrote that song. He's written...
I didn't realize he wrote that song.
Yeah, yeah. If you listen to it, you can hear the same melodic kind of structure. And of course, Bonnie Tyler also did Total Eclipse of the Heart, which is his most famous track. But that's an awesome song. I hesitate to put it on this list because it's not really...
Because it's so awesome?
Even though it is pretty overtly cheesy lyrically, it's just such an awesome song.
We're not negating the awesomeness. I think... Eye of the Tiger is an awesome song.
I guess that's true. Eye of the Tiger is a good song. You're
just
right.
Just to be a cheesy 80s song. I mean, that is completely...
So, yeah. Okay. Holding Out for a Hero. Where have all the good men gone?
And where are all the gods? That's where's the streetwise Hercules to fight the rising odds? Hey, come on. That's totally it, man.
It's also weird because that's the only one I can think of that's from a girl's perspective.
With the thunder rising with the heat. It's gonna take a Superman to sweep me off my feet.
It's not at all like I'm gonna fight and get glory. It's all about where's the big, strong, macho man. Well,
holding out for a hero is the opposite end of that, because every other song is about, I'm about to go kick that guy's ass. Like, that's every 80s anthem is like, let's work out.
Well, that's interesting, because this is, it's like the girl's
and then this is the one that's like, where is the guy coming to kick this guy's ass?
Yeah, she's like, all the other songs we said are, I'm going to become the hero. And she's like, I'm waiting for you. I'm waiting for you. That's
what
it's all
about. She's holding out for that 80s guy. Where's my Karate Kid? That's this song. All I got is this fool dancing in a barn.
Is that
what am I doing?
Is that
in
the
this
song
movie?
They have during the tractor race? I can't remember what they do during that. That
maybe. That may be true.
That's a good song, man. Race. That's a good soundtrack, movie. Actually. That's incidentally, I believe that was the first tape I ever bought as a kid. It's either that or
I'm
the Ghostbuster soundtrack. I can't remember which.
I was too young to like Footloose as a movie, and I, of course, didn't like dancing movies, but everyone loved the Footloose soundtrack.
Oh, man, good stuff. Let's Hear It for the Boy. That's a good track.
Yeah. Dancing in the Sheets.
Dancing in the Sheets.
And I cannot remember, now that we're here, I cannot remember, there is the song that they play while he's doing his intense dancing in the barn to work off all his stress. And I should remember it because I just saw that movie Hot Rod a couple of months ago, and Hot Rod does a moment where he goes to his special place and he does like this little dancing scene and they play that song. And it was so funny in the movie because I'm in the theater and I'm like, I'm the only person here old enough to understand this reference. Like, these kids have no idea. The people who are young enough to want to see Hot Rod have never seen Footloose.
Oh, man, you got Almost Paradise.
Oh, that's a good song, That's a good soundtrack. If we do like the top 80s soundtracks.
Bang Your Heads on there, might... Waiting for a Girl Like You, that great Foreigner song, Hurt So Good from Mellencamp. That's good stuff.
That's actually, that really
Somebody's
is good
Eyes,
song.
That Carla Bonoff. Is that how you say it?
That's a good song, too. Somebody's Eyes are watching.
So this is a song. Good, this is an excellent soundtrack. I'd put this at the top 10 soundtracks, probably, in pound for pound.
The 80s was all about soundtracks, so they better turn out some of the heavy hitters, you know?
What we'll do is we'll do an episode at some point of like a perfect 10 soundtracks, and we'll each make one because I think it'd be interesting, the contrast, what the two of us think are different.
And yeah, if I'd like
Greg
to see that. And I'd like
along,
us to,
that'd be fun too.
To talk about music some more than we do movies, because we do talk about movies a lot. But we're talking about music from movies, so we're still on a playing field that we can work with. You know what's a good anthem? That isn't an action movie at all.
That should be in an action movie, perhaps?
It could be in an action movie, but it's actually not. It's just the theme from St. Elmo's Fire.
Oh, yeah.
The, gonna be a man in motion. All I need is a pair of wheels. Whatever that means. I can see it. See the eagle flying higher and higher.
I think that they probably totally wrote that for an action movie, and then someone said, hey, this is a decent song. Let's get make a movie and call it this.
Yeah, exactly. This is great. Let's make a movie called St. Elmo's Fire. I've got this weird teen angsty movie with Rob Lowe in it. It doesn't have a title yet. Because that is exactly what
fit.
It feels like.
It doesn't fit at all.
There's nothing uplifting about that. It's a great song. That's John Parr, man.
I hear that song, and I'm seeing Van Damme, like, you know, lifting weights. I'm seeing Swayze running around a lake,
I
like
know,
I said before.
Some kid learning ninjutsu from the ghost of Bruce Lee or some crap. I'm not seeing Emilio Estevez riding up to Aspen to make a pass at some doctor lady.
that doesn't fit at all. That song is awesome, though. That's another example of a good example of just that 80s pump, fist-pumping action, you know, that makes
that
you want to...
That just shows you the 80s was turning those things out so much that they didn't even have movies to support them. They're like, I have this awesome song, and I need to put it in a movie. What do I do? We're not making any karate movies this year. Like, fine, just put it in this movie.
If we ever get the ability or the opportunity to make an awesome action movie, We'll put that in there.
Yeah, that would be great. During the final fight scene. On the same token, here's another movie that is not an action-y movie that has an awesome 80s-style anthem, which is Mannequin. Had that Starship song in it. Like, one of the most famous soundtrack songs that Nothing's Gonna Stop Us Now. You don't remember that?
I do remember the song. I'm just trying to picture how that makes me want to pump iron.
Well, I think this is more like the 80s wasn't just pumping iron, but it always had the, you know, against all odds, we're gonna have our secret, like, crazy romantic love affair.
It is the underdog thing. It is like, yeah, we're gonna rise up against all odds kind of stuff.
If this world runs out of lovers, we'll still have each other. You know,
that was what's their faces? Jefferson.
That's Grace Slick.
Starship.
Back in her day.
Before
Grace Slick.
Is that after? Now, or is that just Starship?
They were just Starship.
They kept changing their names.
Man, well, all right, I'm going to call myself out. That's from the No Protection album. which was strictly, I guess it would be. That is the album that followed Knee Deep in Hoopla and was strictly Starship. I owned that album on cassette.
Wow. Got any others?
Let's see.
Are you all tapped out already?
No. You know what we didn't mention, which is an entire cool soundtrack too? And the reason that this is a totally 80s soundtrack is because this movie was actually produced by Berry Gordy, which is The Last Dragon.
I don't remember any songs on that. What songs are on that?
Well, aside from having the famous line of Vanity saying, "Let's rock on with DeBarge." And then they went into the rhythm of the night. To the beat of the rhythm of
the
night.
Isn't that song in
a...
Oh, no, that's not that's not in Short Circuit, but he did a song for Short Circuit. He did that Who's Johnny song.
DeBarge did. Oh, yeah, that was DeBarge, too. Oh, Lord. But The Last Dragon has a nice little anthematic little song at the end because it goes, has the, "You are the last dragon. You possess the power of the glow." And he catches a bullet in his teeth. Bruce Leroy versus Shonuff, the Shogun of Harlem.
Man, that's a movie from the vault too.
Yeah, I almost mentioned that as our movie from the vault, but we're talking about it anyway. So,
that's
Over the Top has a little Kenny Loggins.
Over the Top, yeah.
Oh,
see, I should have thought of that.
Meet me halfway across the sky. And Sammy Hagar does a song on that soundtrack too. What's the Sammy Hagar song?
Oh, I don't know. I'm going to have to look this up, too. I'm so unprepared. Sammy Hagar does a song on the Footloose soundtrack, too.
I know. Kenny Loggins also had a song on the Footloose soundtrack that people remember. So he was doing something right. In fact, Hagar versus Loggins might be happening.
That would be an interesting episode.
might be time to get those cats to hash this
Maybe
out.
Maybe throw Brian Adams in. He was the soundtrack whore of the 90s.
Brian Adams, who came into the 90s.
He kind of kicked Loggins off the throne and took over there.
Brian Adams versus Kenny Loggins would be a more interesting fight. Foot loose, kick loose. Mama Jama Caboose. Yeah. I don't even know the songs. Who we shall we take a taste of whole wheat? What the hell is that song? Are there any real words at all?
Back in college, this is something people don't know, that a little exposition for you. Back in college, we all worked at a radio station. That's how we kind of got started into this kind of nonsense. And Sean did a show. It was a college station, of course. That's why we were at college, right? So Sean did a specialty show about soundtracks. So he's the soundtrack guy. He knows soundtracks. Greg, incidentally, knows soundtracks really well, too, but not because he did a show, but because that's what he chooses to listen to on his own time. And that's fine.
Hey, man, I love soundtracks.
I do, too. I mean, they're fun because they're like, they're all mixes, you know? It's not,
That's the thing I like about them the most, because it's so hard to find a band that you want to listen to through a whole album now. And soundtracks sort of make it easy because not only is it an anthology of bands, but it ties into something that you may already enjoy. You know, we haven't mentioned Irene Cara at all.
Whoa. Especially talking about 80s. What else is there? Flashdance? What else?
Flashdance is the one. What a Feeling. Well, she did fame also.
Yeah, yeah. I guess.
And
that's...
she did a song on DC Cab.
Well, that puts her in the Hall of Fame for you.
Exactly. Although I don't right now remember the song.
If a guy had done fame and had a guitar solo in it, I think that that probably could work. You know, that I want to live forever. I want to learn how to fly. I mean,
every episode we have a piece of advice for people out there listening to make them famous.
Yeah.
And this is this one. Someone could totally redo that Fame theme song. Because that's an idea that originated in the 80s that is not dead. Because that just make it stronger. I want to learn to fly high.
That's an American Idol song waiting to happen, man.
That is totally an American Idol song because it's all about I want to live forever, you know.
We're going to have to do a soundtrack episode. That's just all there is to it.
Well, maybe when Greg comes back, we'll just have him dip into his CD collection.
Well, it'll be nothing but Disney. I don't want to pick on Greg. I don't, because he's not here. And he's a big dude that could totally break me in half, no question. But he does have on his iPod, I'm not kidding, he's got the songs from the theme rides at Disneyland. Like, you know, all the rides at Disneyland each have their own song. He's got those on his iPod.
I'm starting to understand his reticence to do a music episode now.
He's going to kill me. He's going to hear this and he's going to kill me. Good thing I'm listening to these pump up volume, you know, these fist pumping songs. Really. I need to start working out right now for
just
real.
Just as soon as it comes out, you just go, it's in the way that you use it.
And then like, just whoop-ah.
Act like you're going to beat him up with a pull
noodle
cue.
Kick, van damage. Whoop-ah. Yeah. Wata. That's the sound I make that you make fun of.
Wata is a good one.
You got any others?
There are a lot of these songs. We didn't talk about the Greatest American Hero theme, which to me almost counts as an anthem, although it's not a power ballad, but it's totally like, believe it or not, I'm walking on
air. That song, again, if it had been performed differently, would probably fit right in. It's just a little too soft, a little too folky, the way they do it.
Maybe we'll just steal that. Yeah, you can keep that one, America, because I must put my band together and do that song.
But if Hagar had done that, you know, believe it or not, I'm
walking on air.
You got to throw some of that in there. But anyway, we have digressed quite a bit.
I believe that we have completely tapped this scene.
Well, there's other stuff out there that we haven't thought of, but I'm telling you guys, so download all the songs we've mentioned, put them together in a mix, you're ready to go, man.
Yeah, play it while you work out or play video games, and all of a sudden you'll be like, this rocks.
Yeah, I feel like...
Like if you're just listening to it somewhere, but then like, put it in context, man, that's what their soundtrack songs.
I feel like kicking it up a notch. That's what it makes you want to do, kick it up a notch.
Yeah.
You're in the gym, you know, and you got the however many pounds on, and the guy spotting you is like, you don't want more, do you? And you're like, no. I think I do want more. And he throws one more weight on there because you're like, you're the best around. And he starts pumping, you know. Well, there you have it. That's our suggestion for a mix for whatever. And
go get pumped.
Go get pumped.
Dog freezing.